morning, folks, and welcome to our online worship service for the 30th of January 2022. And a special welcome to those of you joining us from outside of the St. Joseph Island area. We are hopeful that we will be in a position to confidently re-enter the sanctuary within the next few weeks. A decision will be made by Island Council as we see how the province and the local health officials assess the changing pandemic data. And notification, of course, will go out via email or phone once a decision has been made. Now, we are approaching the time of Lent in a little over a month, and it's common in many communities to undertake some form of Bible or book study during Lent. And I'd like to call your attention to an online book study led by the United Church clergy in our area. It's called Death of Jesus for Progressive Christians, and it examines how Jesus' death was perceived in the early church and explores how this understanding of the death of Jesus changes everything. And it will be offered Tuesday evenings at 7 p.m. via Zoom from March 8th through April 5th. And you can register by contacting Emmanuel United Church in the Sioux at 705-946-4949 or by email at emmanuel.min@shaw.ca. And the cost is $16 for the book, and registration deadline is February the 3rd. So let's get on with our church bulletin joke. The preacher was wired for sound with a lapel mic, and as he preached, he moved briskly around the platform, yanking the mic cord as he went. And then he moved to one side and getting wound up in the cord and nearly tripping before yanking it again. After several circles and yanks, a little girl in the third pew leaned towards her mother and whispered, "If he gets loose, will he hurt us?" Let us center ourselves for our worship. We light this light in the name of the Maker who lit the world and breathed life into us. We light this light in the name of the Son who saved the world and stretched out his hand to us. We light this light in the name of the Spirit who encompasses the world and blessed our souls with yearning. Thousands of years, First Nations people have walked in this land. Their relationship with the land is at the center of their lives and spirituality. Here on St. Joseph Island, we are gathered on the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe, of the Ojibwe, Ottawa, and Potawatomi, who are partners with the settler peoples in the Robinson-Huron Treaty of 1850. And we acknowledge their stewardship of the land throughout the age. I invite you to join with me in our call to worship. Today, the words of God come to us in love, inviting us not to be afraid, but to place our faith in God. Today, the word of God comes to us in faith, inviting us to trust in the one who knows us, to place our hope in the one who saves us. Today, the word of God comes to us in hope, inviting us to be gracious in our love and in our service to others. Thank you. invite you to join with me in a time of prayer. Rescuing God, your wall of hope surrounds us in our despair. Your haven of faith welcomes us in our unbelief. Your citadel of love protects us from our anger. Gracious Word, you reach out to those we would dare not touch. You greet those we ignore on a daily basis. You welcome those we would close our hearts to. Holy Spirit, rest gently upon us, so we might become kinder people. Caress us with your humility, so we could let go of our pride. Show us your way, so we would not demand ours. God in community, holy in one, our hope, our faith, our love, hear us as we pray. The good news is that in our God we find that safe place for our lives. In God's forgiveness, we are offered the healing that we need. In God's acceptance, we discover the love in which we may abide in every moment of our lives. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our Hebrew scripture reading this morning is taken from the writings of the prophet Jeremiah, chapter 1, verses 4 through 10. Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, and before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations." Then I said, "Ah, Lord God, truly I do not know how to speak, for I am only a boy." But the Lord said to me, "Do not say, 'I am only a boy,' for you shall go to all whom I send you, and you shall speak whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord." Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth, and the Lord said to me, "Now I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and over kingdoms, to pluck up and pull down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant." Our responsive psalm this morning is Psalm 71, verses 1 through 6. And if you have a Voices United, you'll find that on page 789. And we'll be reading part 1. In you, O God, I seek refuge. May I never be disappointed. In your righteousness, save and rescue me. Incline your ear and deliver me. Be a sheltering rock for me, a fortress where I may find safety. For you are my rock and my stronghold. Rescue me, O God, from the hand of the wicked, from the grasp of the unjust and cruel. For you are my hope, my trust from my youth. From the time of my birth, I have leaned on you. The epistle this morning is taken from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 13, verses 1 through 13. Paul writes, If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and I have all faith as to move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now, faith, hope, and love abide, these three. And the greatest of these is love. This is offered as God's wisdom for our journey. May we walk in its truth.
I'll be loving you always, with a love that's true always. When the things you've planned need a helping hand, I will understand always, always.
George S. Kaufman is said to have told Irving Berlin that the lyrics to this famous song, Always, should have been not, I'll be loving you always, but instead, I'll be loving you Thursday. I wonder if you know what he was getting at. When I was in theological school, we had a couple of sessions in our pastoral theology class about preparing a marriage ceremony, including the obligatory meetings with the minister. One of my classmates asked the professor what sort of questions we should ask at these meetings. Our professor looked out at all these eager, aspirant ministers and said, "The most important question to ask is, what are you going to do when you fall out of love?" I remember that we were all shocked by this question. What was this woman asking us to do? Did she seriously expect us to rain on a young couple's parade when we all knew that they would answer in utter sincerity that theirs was the truest, purest love that had ever been experienced in the history of the world, and that they couldn't imagine not being in love with each other. Our professor just laughed and smiled back at us and assured us that we would get over it. And then, just as we began to suspect that she was trying to be some jaded, cynical curmudgeon, she said to us, "They won't believe you at that meeting, but one day they will. And when that day comes, you want them to remember that you said to them that that will be the day when the work of real love begins." Our reading this morning is, of course, that famous passage that's requested by couples at their wedding more than any other passage of Scripture. I'll wager you have not only heard it read at virtually every wedding you've ever attended, but that you've heard it preached about and sung about just about as often as well. It's that well-known passage from the 13th chapter of Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, also known as Paul's Song of Love. I'll also bet that the number one reason why people request such a passage is simply because the word love is used there more often than anywhere else in Scripture. It's hardly ever because anybody is thinking about or talking about what Paul meant by the word. So let's be clear. Paul was not talking about all those warm, gushy feelings you and I have when we first find somebody we really like. He's not talking about those romantic expressions of love that people tend to wax sentimentally about at weddings. In fact, he's not talking about the kind of love that we feel for someone else at all. He's talking about the kind of love that you and I need precisely when those warm, gushy, sentimental, nostalgic feelings vanish into thin air. The people at Corinth may have been nice people, but they certainly weren't acting nice towards each other. That's the first and most important thing to remember about this famous passage. As John Calvin once said of them, "Among the Corinthians, no slight number had gone astray. In fact, almost the whole body was infected. There was not one kind of sin, but very many. And they were no light errors, but frightful misdeeds. There was corruption, not only of morals, but of doctrine." If you wanted jaded, cynical curmudgeon Calvin, he's your guy. Corinth was a bitterly divided congregation. Factions all over the place, backbiters and name-callers, gossips and power players, carryings on behind closed doors. Absolutely shameful stuff. You name the kind of problems that you can find when human beings get together, especially religious people, and the church at Corinth had all of them. It was one of the most troublesome congregations that Paul ever had to contend with. He was not proud of what had become of them. And some of the harshest things he ever had to say, he said to them. All of which was surprising in a way, because it was a church that on one hand had everything going for it. They had no deficit of enthusiasm, energy, and talent, And with all those assets, there was no good reason why they shouldn't have been successful. Why they shouldn't have been a shining example of Christ. But somehow, they had missed the mark. And not by a bit, but by a long shot. And the reason Paul wrote this beautiful passage about love was not to commend them for what they were doing, but to chastise them for what they had failed to do. And if you read it with that in mind, it becomes perfectly clear what Paul is saying. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Paul is talking about all the things that the Corinthians have stopped doing. Being patient, kind, long-suffering, and faithful. He's also talking about the kind of things that they persisted in doing. Being envious, boastful, arrogant, rude, irritable, and hoping others will make a mistake. Paul is not talking about the love that comes naturally. He's talking about the love that is essential when the honeymoon ends. In a couple of weeks, most of us will be conned into celebrating Valentine's Day. Why? Because retailers would surely go broke if they couldn't be permitted to take that hard-earned cash out of our pockets, simply so that we can indulge our notions of romantic love. It's a day dreamed up not by St. Valentine, but by florists and greeting card manufacturers and the makers of fine chocolate. Lay your cash on the counter and cure all your love problems. Now, please don't misunderstand me. I will line up with all the other suckers and buy a gift for Heather because I love her, even if I'm not lovey-dovey romantic all the time. I have no axe to grind with the patron saint of romantic love. I think it's one of the most beautiful gifts God has given us. But it is a short-lived reality. We do fall out of love with each other in time. The people we end up marrying, the people we admire, the people we befriend, the people we meet in church, the people who, in the first flush of delight, appear to us to be just what we have been looking for. Now, did you hear what I just said? Just what we have been looking for. And that is the key. As research scientists also have a way of reminding us at this time of the year, love is as much a chemical reaction in the brain as it is anything else. And the presence of that natural amphetamine, phenylthiamine, that the body produces when we find ourselves attracted to another human being affects how we want to see them. We see other people the way we want to see them, which makes it a whole lot easier to be in love with them at times than seeing them the way they really are. And that is why it's a temporary experience. Why it simply doesn't last. The drug our body produces begins to wear off, the velvet fog begins to lift, and we begin to see people as they really are. And that's where the fun begins. Well, not exactly fun, if you know what I mean, but when things get very interesting in a relationship. It is the moment of truth, in other words. The time we find out just how committed we are to each other's well-being. You may have noticed, I'm sure, that in the service of matrimony, the minister never asks, "William, do you love Mary?" but instead asks, "William, will you love Mary?" It's not the fact that William and Mary love each other now that we are there to celebrate, but the fact that they are there to promise to love each other, for better, for worse, in sickness and health, in joy and sorrow, from now on. In other words, to love the other even at 3:30 in the morning when the baby is crying and with a terrible cold in the head and when the bills have to be paid. The love that is affirmed at a wedding is not just a condition of the heart, but an act of the will. The promise to will the other's good, even at the expense sometimes of your own. And that is quite a promise. That's the love that marriage is meant to symbolize. Not St. Valentine, but St. Paul. Not romantic love, but Christ's love for the church. The love that sticks when the other varieties have left town. I really like the story about the couple celebrating their 40th anniversary with a quiet dinner for two. The wife picks up her champagne glass and says, "In spite of everything." St. Valentine might not approve, but I think Paul would have. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. The real thing, that is. Love at first sight, love at first blush, love in the first few months of any relationship. That's the easy stuff. But when I have to think about loving you Thursday, that's the real thing. Thanks be to God. Amen. It's been said in stewardship circles that money follows mission, and it's true. People invest in things that they can get excited about. Some will give to fill the hole in the budget, but most give to the things that the church does to make a difference in the world. May we hear the words spoken to Jeremiah as if they were spoken to us. "Look, today I have set you over the nations and kingdoms to build and to plant." Please join with me as we offer thanks to God for the gifts that we have shared. We do not need to speak in tongues except to offer words of encouragement. We do not have to know all things, just those which lift the burdens off those around us. We do not need to give everything, but we will join our gifts with those of others to reach out in love to those who have nothing. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please join with me once again in a time of intercessory prayer. Loving God, our hearts speak in grateful praise for all that you are and all that you have done. Your mercies are many and your blessings bountiful. We give thanks for your touch in all of life's situations. You are the one who turns lives around. You convict us for our faults in a gentle manner. Enable us to keep our priorities straight, putting you at the top of all circumstances and situations. Remind us again and again that our families are our second priority. Forgive us for so often placing them much further down the list. We thank you for those who continue to do good in the midst of a very individualistic and selfish world. We thank you for the simple kindnesses that are experienced each day, for those who care for us, for those who help us, for those who offer wise insights, even if we don't want to hear them, for those who stop to help someone in need or offer support in difficult times. For all of these people, and for many more, we give our thanks. In the midst of our thanks, we lift up in prayer the needs of this church and community. We pray for those who mourn. Give us peace in the midst of our grief. Give us healing in the midst of our hurts. Bless us with your soothing spirit. We pray also for those who are sick this day. Keep all those who are ill in your special care. Heal us and protect us from all that would harm us. God of grace and glory, hear our prayers, remind us of our blessings, and lift us up above our weariness. Shine your light upon us so that we may shine your love to others. For all of these things and more, we pray in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
We shall go out from strength to strength, go on.
God touches our mouths so we may go out to share the good news. Jesus touches our hands so that we may serve all in need of life and hope. The Spirit touches our hearts so we may be a haven for those who are longing for acceptance and love. May the God of love and justice accompany us. May the Spirit surround us with grace and peace as we walk the way of the Christ. Let all those who do justice and love kindness say Amen. Shalom, everybody. I'll see you next week.